I'm Jacqueline Apser, for those of you who are wonderful guests, so the president of the Bedford Club. And this is one of the events we absolutely love doing, which is to have a multi-club event, bring in lots of guests, a number of youth, people that we're working with, our exchange children or students, excuse me, that we're very happy to have with us this evening. So thank you for that. I would like to proceed a bit differently tonight. We have a number of things we want to do. One special part of the program beforehand, and then we really want Victor to move on to his program tonight. So we don't want to take too much time. But I would like to mention that we have two district governors with us tonight. We have our special guest, Dave Gardner, who is from the Burlington and Lexington. And do they have a name beyond 7930?
I'm from the Stone Club.
Oh, I didn't know that. The Stoneham Club. So great. Welcome. And also we have Karen Gaffney, who is our district governor, and she's from the Neshoba Valley Club. And we're delighted to have you with us as well. I know our assistant governor, Pam Anastasi, is coming this evening. She may be a little late because she had a meeting ahead of time, but she would want to say hello to you herself if she could be here. So we're happy to have her. I would like to move a little bit more quickly in terms of, you know, welcoming so many people. This is really, really wonderful. So thank you. Do keep eating. And I would like to bring up right now Bob Cassidy for a special presentation this evening.
Thank you, Jacqueline. Now I got to have glasses. Cannot see without the glasses. Okay. So what is this thing that we call Rotary? If you ask non-Rotarians, you'll probably get told that it's a bunch of folks having lunch. I think they have something to do with polio. And oh yeah, I think they give out scholarships too. If you ask Rotarians what is Rotary, many of us will stumble through talking about one or more of the specific projects which we've been involved in. Well, they're both partially correct. Our little club of Bedford gives out $7,500 worth of those scholarships every year. Many clubs do. Now, why don't you multiply that $7,500 by the 34,000 Rotary clubs around the world? And don't forget to throw in the Peace Scholars at $50,000 a pop. And we have something to do with polio. We've raised over $500 million, and we've inoculated over 2 billion, that's billion with a B. As the saying goes, we're this close. As I looked at the website today, there are no new reported cases so far in the last bunch of months. The truth is, most of us Rotarians do a terrible job about talking about what it is that we do. Why? Because we're not interested in giving ourselves credit for what we do. We see a problem, people in need, and we fix the problem. And then we move on to the next problem. Rotary International and its clubs undertake and complete thousands upon thousands of projects, big and small, in our local communities and all around the world. We also raise and dispense millions of dollars each year to fund and complete these projects. So where does the millions come from? Well, Rotarians donate a lot of it themselves. Rotarians raise some of it in a variety of fundraisers. And the rest comes from corporations. And it's this piece of where the millions come from that we'd like to begin to acknowledge this evening. We very well recognize that we could not do what it is that we do without the help of many. Our Rotary Club of Bedford has gotten the unwavering support of many corporations, and we are beginning this program tonight to say a public and permanent thank you to them. So the first, if I could have, I want to talk about BAE Engineering. So if I could have Michael Corelli, the site manager, and Cheryl Hafferty, the deputy site commander, please come up. Over the past 4+ years, our club has worked with Rise Against Hunger in an effort to feed children needing nutritious meals. We have cumulatively packaged and shipped more than 300,000 meals. BAE Engineering has been and is instrumental in the success of this program. Financially, they are responsible for raising the funds to feed more than 68,900 children. And this year, they will feed an additional 17,200 children in our April 2018 packaging event. On the other side, every year that we've had a packaging event, BAE Engineering has supplied at least 50 team members to help us package those meals. So on behalf of the Rotary Club of Bedford, I want to extend our sincere appreciation to you and the rest of your corporation for everything that you've done for us. Okay, next, take the hat off, Joe, is flatbread pizza. Joe, can you come on? Joe Silva, can you come up? Flatbread pizza has been a supporter of the Rotary Club of Bedford since its inception, meaning flatbreads, a number of years ago. Each year, they hold a fundraiser for us, and they raise over $2,000. They've participated in both labor, equipment, and materials in the Pan Mass Kids Ride here in Bedford for each of the last 4 to 5 years. They've contributed some of the food supplies for our Breakfast with Santa every year. They have, at Joe's idea, I think, they have a portable pizza oven, which they don't laugh. They very, very amiably bring that thing to Bedford Day, and along with the labor and the materials, to produce 180 pizzas every year.
Watch your finger.
Oh, okay. And in addition to all of that, they help us each year with our Meals for Kids program, supplying in excess of 50 pizzas every year to feed our 350 volunteers. So Joe, on behalf of all of this, and I can't even begin to tell you all the other things that you folks have done for us over the years, we want to recognize Flatbread as one of our major sponsors.
Mm-hmm. Excellent.
And finally, the first part of our list, this is the first year we're doing this, would not be complete without recognizing the Hilton DoubleTree Bedford Glen Hotel. So Amy Castrello, the manager of the hotel, could you please come up? Hi, Amy.
How are you?
I won't embarrass you too much.
Please don't.
Our club has met in this hotel for over 15 years. In addition to feeding us exceptionally well, which you folks have found out this evening, they are constantly helping us with a wide variety of things. Projection equipment every week when we need it. Ice for all the fundraisers whenever we need it. And if you've ever sold food in recent years, the Board of Health can be rather intimidating. And their ice really helps. Consumables for our fundraisers when we need them. Storage for our club banners, our flags, and all of that stuff. Refrigeration for our consumables when we go shopping before an event and hold it until the day of the event. Stability for the cost of our meals over a number of years. Preparation of special meals for one of our senior members who has to have everything pureed, and they do it without blinking an eye. It's the only way he can come to the meetings, and we really appreciate it. A staff that does an excellent job of preparing the room for our weekly meetings and seeing to it that our culinary needs are always cheerfully met. This list goes on and on. I could not list them all, but save it to say that their efforts contribute measurably to who we are as a Rotary Club. So congratulations. And thank you.
I just want to say, this is our Robert Cassidy. I don't think there's anyone in the room who doesn't know him, because I haven't met anyone yet who hasn't known him. But if you don't know him, he is just one of our mainstays, with Ralph and Jim and a number of other people that just make our club as good as it can get. So I say thank you, Bob, very much. All right, without much further ado, I think we're going to hand it over to the man of the hour. Our baseball.
Debbie's on it.
Oh, sorry.
Actually, Melinda's going to do it.
Oh, I think you guys were handing up. Yeah.
Okay.
All right. Oh, here
I
we
go. I am honored.
Honored.
To introduce Mr. Dr. Victor Tom is Chief Scientist of BAA Systems. He will be presenting a talk tonight that he previously presented to the Major League Baseball Hall of Fame at Cooperstown, New York.
Woo!
Yeah.
Woo!
Thank you. Okay, before I go into my talk, I've got a few advertisements. Come on April 21st for our Meals for Kids packing program. And John said I ought to mention some of the other programs that we do, projects. So we have right now an active educational program in Kenya, funded by a global grant with partners from Beverly Hills Club and Rotary China, to help us do a remedial education high school level program, self-paced, that will reintegrate students who have dropped out of high school in three different high schools in Kenya. And we are also tracking down a water project in Nepal. So if you're interested and your club wants to hear about some of these things, let me know. Okay, so on to the program. So as we said, I gave this talk and was well received by even umpires at the Baseball Hall of Fame. So what do these things have in common? Okay? Well, they have relatively smooth trajectories. And if you're looking at them in the right way, for missiles, you're looking up at the sky. Or for baseball, if you're looking down on the grassy green field, the backgrounds are pretty benign. So it's a pretty easy thing to detect where these things are. So I'm going to give you a little history. I joined Atlantic Aerospace back in 1986, which was a high-tech company, a couple of directors of DARPA, and my professor, Al Oppenheim, who Al Wuski knows, who's right in the audience. So we were a really high-tech company. We do tracking and detection of really hard stuff. And so I was asked in 1992 to help the America's Cup team, because that was a professor at MIT, Bill Koch, who wanted to round up all the MIT smart people he could find in the Boston area and help them win the America's Cup. So I was put on the image processing team. And so we had a technique where we could, you see by the picture, we would want to figure out where the horizon was, because the boats are tilting, the cameras are swaying all over the place. If we could lock on the horizon, we could create a map of where the texture is rough, and that's where the wind was. So you imagine the guy in the sailboat looking down on his laptop and seeing a map where he's pointed and where the wind was. That's a tremendous advantage. So we did that for the start of the race, the first leg, because it turned out we couldn't put it up on the top of our sailboat because the cables were too heavy. These are million-dollar masts, so you don't want to break them. So we put them on the support boat, but we could still get a good view of the entire first leg of the race. So what happened? We won the cup. So my technique was really good. And the rules committee, after this race, they said, you know, in the next 4 years, we're going to outlaw your technique. So sailors are supposed to look for the wind. You're not supposed to give it to them. So unfortunately, we did our job too well. At the same time, in 1987, so this is a couple of years before the America's Cup, a couple of Wall Street investors, Ed Plumacher and Ron Klumkowski, and when I was growing up, I knew who Ron Klumkowski was. You know, he was a Yankees baseball pitcher, and my favorite team back then was the Yankees, because I was growing up in New Jersey. Phil Rizzuto, I heard, used to go to my dad's restaurant in New Jersey. So Northrop Grumman sold them, or maybe they went to Northrop Grumman and asked them, we want to buy your missile tracking system, the one that's optically based on cameras. And so I think Northrop Grumman really sold them a bill of goods. But anyway, they were able to parlay that investment into providing a service. They tried to sell it to the teams, but the team said, nah, we don't want that. That, you know, what are we going to do with a system like that? So they went into business, and they, for many years, they were just kind of doing onesies, twosies, broadcast events, where they provide enhanced graphics to the TV stations. And my friend and I, Paul Baim, we saw the Fox broadcast in 1999 of the World Series. So they put it up, they got somehow managed to get it shown on the first telecast of the World Series with this tracking system. And we saw it, and then my friend asked me, he says, hey, can't we do stuff like that? We do tracking? And I said, yeah, that's trivial. So we invited Questec, who was the company who did that. We saw them on the TV logo, and we invited them to, hey, come up to Atlantic Aerospace, you know, from New York, and we want to show you what we did for the America's Cup, and we want to tell you how to do your system better. So they came up, and I pitched, I told them what I thought they were doing, and then I said, this is how you should be doing it. And they said, okay, if you think you can do it, bring a system to Fenway Park in 6 months. And we'll do a bake-off. So we got internal research funding. Paul Baim was our project manager. I was the PI. And we had a lot of fun. People wanted to work on this thing. And so we had the bake-off. We brought together a system. We did it in time. And they were so impressed with our system, they never turned on their system. And we got the contract. And so that was kind of mysterious to me, but what it turned out was the Questech tracking system was very limited. It's extremely labor intensive. They had to use a guy with a surveying transom to figure out where the cameras were, precisely, where they were pointed. And then the operator had to prime the system. You know, you hit a key for every single pitch. Very manual intensive. And they used outdated equipment. An old PC, Northrop Grumman sold them a bill of goods. And an old PC, and they had these specialized image processing boards that you can no longer buy. And they searched the world over for the last few boards, and they still didn't have enough if they wanted to put them in every park. And that was the key. This was no longer a sustainable product. So when they saw our system using modern equipment, you know, off-the-shelf PCs, no specialized image processing board, they jumped at the opportunity. So we set up a lab at Fenway Park. We got a free parking pass. It was right across the street, I forget, Gate C or whatever it is, right across the street from where the players park. So that's how close we were. Yeah, that was worth a lot. We had media credentials. We had a lab in the main control room where all the action was. And so we saw a lot of free games. We would say at the end of the working day, may remember some of those days where we would announce to the office, hey, anybody want to go watch a game? Help us lug some equipment. So that was a lot of fun. That's the main control room. And we were at the back, you know, so we're at our wall looking out. So whenever there was something exciting and we were in the control room, we could run right to the front window. The announcers for the TV were right there, right below us. The organist was up above us. And the owner's box was next door to us. So that's how good this location was. And the cafeteria was right behind us. And the free beer and pretzels were right behind us as well. So this is looking at Fenway Park. And so our camera placements had to be high so we could see the pitching corridor. That's where the ball travels between the pitcher and home plate. So that's where one camera was, right below the roof rafters. And that's where the other one was. So you can see, you know, 90 degrees, pretty good angle separation, good stereo effect. And if you look up here, that's where one camera was, that's where the other one was, that's what they looked like. You can see it's clamped to the girders. And then also, not only do we need to track the pitch, we needed to know where the upper and lower boundaries of the strike zone were. So we needed to capture the pictures of the batters. So we had the dugout cameras. There's one. And that's what it looked like. Right at the edge of the dugout, that's a zoom in. These are just standard surveillance cameras with weatherproof shields. But we actually had an incident with one of these cameras. When we set up in the Arizona Fall League, I believe it was, or maybe it was spring training, before Curt Schilling came to the Boston Red Sox, he used to pitch for the Arizona Diamondbacks, right. So in the National League, you bat, okay? We were introducing a system that kind of standardized the strike zone. But Curt Schilling's, you know, strength was he knew the tendencies of every umpire. And he would adapt to the umpires. So when the umpires were telling him, says, I can't adapt because the system is going to, you know, tell the Major League Baseball that I'm not calling the correct strike zone. So I had to call it a ball for you, Curt Schilling. So Curt got kind of angry. So he struck out once, and then as he walked back to the dugout, he walks by one of our cameras. And he takes his bat, and he wallops it. And I know exactly how much they billed him for. Because I don't know if some of you remember, maybe Bob Cassidy might remember, Shonda Schilling came and gave a talk to receive her Paul Harris Award at our district conference. So I asked her at that district conference, I told her, because you know, I used to build this system, and Kirk broke one of our cameras. And she says, yeah, I know. I paid for that. And it was $8,000. Yeah. So going on to the other camera. So that's where we had a center. So that's the broadcast center field camera. That's the one you always see when you're looking kind of at the pitch going to the plate. So we tapped that feed. So we got the broadcast feed during game. So, and we also, the other thing we did was we had a time sync calibration where we put on the audio track of all these cameras. We get all these feeds from all these different cameras and we put a timestamp on every one of those frames coming in. So we knew if we needed to grab a frame at this point in time, we get it from all the cameras together. Okay, so that was key also. So here you see the right and the upper cameras up on the ceiling. And you'll see, I hope, there it goes. Okay, it'll loop through this. You'll see the pitch coming from the pitcher's mound, right to left, left to right, right there. Did you see it? Okay, it'll repeat. So that's what the computer has to analyze. We have to look for that ball coming around between 60 miles per hour and 105 miles per hour. Anything else is a false alarm. So if a guy throws from the outfield and it's not the right speed, it's not a pitch. If a bird flies through the seam, it's not a pitch. If a fan throws a beer, you know, thing at the on the field, it's a false alarm. So that's how we can do this automatically. We didn't have to have an operator prime on every pitch. Okay, this is another view, and you'll see as this video progresses, so those are the points of the ball that you see there. That's how many points we have. And that's probably like a fastball in the 90s or something. And then let me advance this. Okay, it's running. You'll see it kind of pan over to some of the graphics. So that's and then you see the side view and the top view. So we can see that trajectory is a three-dimensional trajectory. So we can project any view of it in relationship to how it crosses the plate. So that's the convincing data we present to the umpires. This system was meant for entertainment first. And then, okay, well, features of the new system. So it's very fast camera calibration. I would put a few pie plates on the field, measure the distances from home plate, hit the button, and it would be done. So you don't have to survey the cameras at all. It figures out from the math where the camera has to be, where it's looking, and what the zoom is. And so we always look for the pitch in the corridor at the right speed, so there's automatic pitch initiation. And since it's, you know, kind of basic off-the-shelf hardware, we could have a path for replicating this in all 32 ballparks. So this is what initially, we did it for entertainment, as I said. So Fox Sportsnet started putting this out in, I guess, 2001. And you could see the path of the pitch. And you could see it piercing the strike zone. Or not. And then here's my favorite one. So the scatter plots of Pedro Martinez. So we could put up the history, you know, for any batter, for any scatter plot of pitches. And in fact, there was an infamous game between the Yankees and the Red Sox. Pedro went up against Roger Clemens. So there was a lot of excitement in the room. And so we had the tracking system going, and people were asking, you know, how's that? How are they doing? You know, and we said, well, Pedro is pitching in the 94 to 95 miles per hour, and he's hitting those corners, and the scatter plot was so minuscule. He's just nailing the corners, and that's why he's getting all these strikeouts. Roger Clemens was about a mile and a half faster, but his scatter plot was bigger. But he was still striking out batters. And so it was really interesting to see the different styles and the effectiveness of their pitches. You know, one was a power, and Pedro was the artist. So after about a year of this, I think there was a dot-com crash, if you all remember. So the business end of this effort was Fox Sports Net was not going to pay us. We had to find our own revenue stream to make it profitable. So we used to put ads on those graphics. So this, you know, graphics brought to you by, you know, IBM, or brought to you by so-and-so. So those advertisements paid us a lot of money and sustained the operation, both for baseball and for tennis. We were on the tennis pro tour. But after the dot-com crash, advertising dollars went through the, you know, down. So, but at the same time, Major League Baseball came to us and said, hey, Sandy Olson, VP of baseball operations and head of the umpiring crew, he came and said, hey, can you increase the accuracy of your system to about half inch? And we said, yeah, we can. We have to give up some of the length of the pitch. We'll use slightly better camera, zoom in, and we demonstrated to Major League Baseball that we could do it at Fenway Park. I was doing pitches from a pitching machine. I was on the mound at Fenway Park throwing pitches at a target, and it was pressure-sensitive plywood, and so I had locations at every single pitch right behind home plate, you know, at the back end where the point is. And our system was telling us where the system thought the ball was piercing that plane. And we demonstrated better than half inch accuracy on that trial. So Major League Baseball was impressed. And so they gave us another contract, or a different contract. So their thing was, we will start to outfit the Major League Baseball stadiums with our system with the high precision. And we're going to help train the umpires so that there is no longer National League umpires and American League umpires. There is one umpire. He will rotate between the two leagues, and he will call the same strike zone. Wow. And that's what they do now. So every umpire was given to carry with him as he went to his games, you know, and so he could look in his hotel room after a game. He would get his CD from our control room 20 minutes after the game. He would get a completely a disc full of information, and he would review his own performance. Okay, that was the theory. That was the theory. So that strike zone is defined as follows. You probably don't all know this. So starting from the bottom, it's the hollow behind the knee. Okay? That was a real problem with Manny Ramirez. If you remember, he always wore baggy pants. Yeah. So that was a problem. But the upper part is defined as the midpoint. It's not at the letters, it's the midpoint between the top of the pants and the top of the lower leading shoulder as he's getting ready to strike the pitch. So it was important for us to grab that frame when the pitch is halfway to the home plate. Remember, we know where that pitch is at any point in time. So we grab that frame. And so the umpire is convinced that he blew the call or he did not blow the call. Most of the good umpires that we saw at the young umpires were only missing about one or two calls per game. I mean, they were really good. And we gave them a little latitude on where it crosses the plate. There's a little black border on the plate. So if the ball pierces any part of the white, he has to call it a strike. If the ball is more than a half ball width off of the black, I think, then it has to be called a ball. Anything else, we won't, you know, he's being forgiven. If he gets it wrong, all right. So, you know, they really should get it right. And so there you see where the strike's on. So our system was not automatic in terms of setting this up. We had the operator, and that's the 20 minutes time period where he sets the lower and bottom really fast for every unique batter. We didn't need to grab the same batter again and again. We just assumed that he's gonna strike it the same way. So, MLB did a switch on us. No longer were we training umpires at some point in time, but we were told, oh, they're gonna decide to use this as a grading system on the umpires. Yeah, the umpires didn't like that too much. So they sued us. They sued Major League Baseball, they sued Atlantic Aerospace, I said that Kurt Schilling didn't like the system either, but that's so it was a lengthy court battle. And they had Professor Adair from Yale University speak on the behalf of the union. They were hoping that he would say that our system was not accurate because it was so cheap. He got up on the stand, and I think Tom Robertson, our boss, was there, and he said that he got up on the stand and said, you know, for the cost of their system, it's remarkably accurate. So the judge threw out the case. So the umpires union said, look, they agreed to the following. They'll accept the grading of the umpiring system if their score got above a certain grade. If it went below that grade, there would be secondary criteria. So this kind of appeased the older umpires who had a lot of seniority, because the grading system affected the assignment of the postseason assignments. They could double their salary by getting into the playoffs in the World Series. That's how lucrative these assignments were. So they weren't going to, you know, miss an opportunity like this. So back in 2007, a couple years after we finished, this is the way it kind of looked if you pulled it up on game day on MLB.com. So I always used to look at the baseball games on TV, and then I have my laptop on the side. And I could mouse over each pitch and see its curvature and its speed. And we can actually get the speed at the point of release from the hand and at the plate. And it drops by about 4 miles per hour. So when they say, oh, he's throwing 100 miles per hour, well, by the time he gets to the batter, it's about 96. And Pedro would throw, you know, 94, 95. But Wakefield, yeah, you think Wakefield was pitching like in the 60 mile per hour range. His pitches were more unpredictable, but since we had so many points along his track, we could track it. So as an epilogue, our involvement ended in 2003. You know, I got to go and help put cameras in, I think, Shea Stadium, the new ballpark. It used to be called the AT&T Bell Park over there in San Francisco. In 2003, that's when Wakefield gave up that bad pitch, the extra innings. So we didn't get to go to the World Series. That was a big disappointment. In 2004, we were no longer involved. The Major League Baseball came and approached us, our technology team, and said, would you like, at cost, a pair of tickets for every game at Fenway Park for 2004. So I got to see the infamous Robert Steele second base. And then I got to see, I think it was the second World Series game at Fenway Park where Curt Schilling had the bloody sock. And then 2004, that's when we won it all. So that was great. So I'll open up for questions. What time is it? I have no idea.
7:45.
Okay, we got some minutes for questions. Go ahead, Joe.
Were you a big baseball fan before this?
Oh, yeah. As soon as I got to MIT back in 68, I just fell in love with the Red Sox because they failed so many times. I think I was a student when what was it? Carlton just was waving, the office. And then Suen was at Stony Brook, and when the Mets and the Red Sox were playing, and was it 86? Yeah. And so she was rooting for the Mets, and I was rooting for the Red Sox. And then Bucky Dent hit that dumb fly ball left field that somehow cleared the wall. Oh, that was a heartbreaker. But at the Baseball Hall of Fame, they got a really nice exhibit now. Before I did this presentation, Sue and I went down there. We did this presentation at the Cooperstown Rotary Club. It turned out that two of the Baseball Hall of Fame senior people were in that club. So they heard my talk, and then they invited us out to lunch the next day. And they said, "We really liked your talk. Would you consider coming and giving this talk at our spring symposium?" And then in the afternoon, they took Sue and I to the Baseball Hall of Fame for a private tour. And they brought us down to the cellar where there's a guard at the door, and then he has to do his, ID to get into this vault. That's where the archives are. He says 90% of the stuff is down here. And so Suen got to hold Babe Ruth's glove. They say, "Well, we got something special for you to hold here." Yeah, it was really crummy looking. But it was great. Someone else? Yeah.
I was going to ask, did you ever look at selling that data that you collected back to the batters for the batters to use?
Oh, the data. Yeah, the data was a mind trove. But since, we were trying to do something along those lines back before Major League Baseball asked us to do the umpiring system. Once they did the umpiring system, they owned all rights. So MLB, I don't know what they do with the data, whether they sell it to the teams or not.
Is it the same system that we see on TV?
There's a new system by Sports Vision on TV now, and it's evolved, but the principles are the same in terms of the stereoscopic look with the two cameras. In fact, they may use three cameras to get a better, tighter error ellipse on that ball position.
And happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Victor.
Thank you.
Happy birthday to you.
Thank you. Oh, I want to blow it out. Okay.
Another World Series.
Jackie.
I want to comment that it's also Mark Zimbleski's birthday today.
Oh, okay. Okay, any other questions on the baseball? Hey,
I'll ask a couple more. Do you think they'll ever convert to strikes being called with technology?
So the question is, will I ever think that the strikes be called automatically by the technology? And they did an experiment in one of the minor leagues The game was completely called automatically. There are no issues. So it's possible, but I kind of like the human element. But my theory is they should have like Google glasses. And they should be able to see the trajectory of the ball after the fact. Because it's so fast, it's really hard to do this in real time. And then they also didn't like my idea of like an electronic cattle prod. So if they got the call wrong, they didn't like that idea. They're more amenable to the Google glasses. But the technology for sports is really getting sophisticated. I was just reading in an IEEE journal that they're even using phased array radars for tracking these balls now. Because with radar, you can get the Doppler of the spin from one side to the other. So they know how fast those balls are spinning. Yeah, that's incredible. So I thought, we tried to get the baseball teams interested. You say, hey, we can replicate the system, put it in your bullpen. So you know how well your pitchers are performing if they're coming off an injury. Or if they're warming up in the bullpen, are they ready for the real-time game? But they weren't interested. So I'm probably the only one in this room who's ever got a rejection letter from Bill Belichick. I sent the letter to Bill Belichick and Matt Patricia and Bob Kraft saying, I'm going to retire soon. I would love to help your team in any way possible with video analysis. And I'll work for $1 a day, So Bill wrote back. He wrote back, which is incredible. He says, we appreciate your interest, but all of our positions are fully staffed at the moment. But I wish you success in all your future football endeavors. And this was on really nice, Super Bowl stadium, stationery, with five trophies, and yeah, it's really nice. And it's got his signed signature of Bill Belichick.
So is that framed up on your wall now?
It will be. It'll be framed right next to my congratulations from the America's Cup, Bill Koch. So one's a congratulations, one's a rejection letter. Mark.
Out of curiosity, what did you think you could analyze with the video for the football and apply it to football?
I don't know what they do now, but I would imagine you could track individual players, their tendencies, their speed. I know that NFL, not a team, but the NFL itself is looking at deep learning to figure out what the teams are doing. they're automatically tracking players. So I imagine that some of the teams with their films are kind of doing the same thing. So looking for tendencies to exploit. Yep. Okay.
Thanks for that.
Yeah, you're welcome.
Back the
Rotary
sign.
What do you want to do?
Put back the
Rotary symbol. Yeah, right. Well, everyone, I hope you enjoyed that. Thank you, Victor. I want to thank again BAE, Flatbread, and Doubletree for all of the work that they do with us, and there are a number of other corporations as well out there that are very helpful. So we're very pleased to have been able to present the awards tonight with this wonderful crowd here. And Victor was the lure, so that was great. So that worked well. We're actually a few minutes early, so I'm going to ring the bell, but please sit and help yourselves with whatever else there's left to eat and drink and be merry. So it was good to have you with us. Thank you. Thank you.